I am Chris Nuernberger, and I'm here to talk to you about high-performance data using Clojure. So not so long ago, Anthony wrote a really good benchmark that he pulled it directly from one of his customer problems. And he is such a gentleman, he emailed me on a weekend or on a Thursday and said, hey, I tried TechML dataset on this benchmark and it really didn't do very good. Do you want to take a look? And I did. And I took a bit of effort, but I eventually worked it down to where TechML dataset dominates everything else by factors. And these are, you know, Julia's language written for high performance. Python's got, I don't know how many years. Pandas has got how many years of development. Spark has, I don't know how many years of development. And then my little dataset library on his exact problem ended up being much, much faster. And I want to talk about, and it's written in Clojure from ground up. And that's just not something you see very often. You don't often see a Clojure program dominating a performance benchmark. So I want to talk a little bit about why, what I built. I built it from the foundation and how I think it can help you structure some of your problems and maybe think about things a little differently. So here's the benchmark code. It's pretty simple. You load a sequence of Parquet files, and I'm careful to load only the columns that I need. And then I create a virtual column called sales out of price and quantity. And then I do a big group by aggregation. And what that does is it groups by member ID, and then it calculates all these derived statistics based off the subdata sets defined by unique member IDs. And one thing I want to impress upon you here is that this code is extremely, performs really well, but it's also very readable. And it really is fairly straight Clojure with a couple twists. So when I left NVIDIA and started working in Clojure, a common comment that people said was, oh my God, can you make Java even slower? I'm not kidding. And that may be just kind of NVIDIA's, you know, NVIDIA cockiness coming through, but it's a fair criticism, I think, from C++. Those of us who grew up writing C++, have written it since the 90s, we remember all the promises that were made about Java. And we remember how few of those promises actually paid off when it comes to performance. But that Java 20 years ago isn't the same Java now. And so what does high performance computing look like on the JVM is the question I want to ask today. Can we write competitive code on the JVM that performs as well as anything anybody else can write? Is there a general structure in high performance code that we can formalize a little bit? Why does working with arrays of data, which are the basic data structure of a machine, feel so obtuse and indirect and painful? And then finally, this is even more interesting. If it's not hard enough to write high performance code, let's add in unique aspects of the JVM. Are there some unique aspects of the JVM that we can leverage when we design our systems that we know other people can't really easily match in any language? And then the final question here is, does any language on the JVM really realize the potential of the JVM? What is the speed of light of the JVM, the fastest stuff on the JVM, and why is it so hard to write it? None of us want to handwrite bytecode, but even if you did, I think you'd find it's fairly hard to reach the potentials of the JVM in various places. So why is that? And to start answering that question, I'm going to talk about a basis for array programming. Array programming has many connotations among people. Some people think it's programming with APL. Some people think it's programming with NumPy. I'm going to break it down to something much more basic. It's programming with contiguous arrays of primitive data structures. So contiguous arrays of bytes, or contiguous arrays of shorts, or contiguous arrays of longs. And what I built was this library, which is called dtype next, which kind of defines a sub language on top of Clojure. And you can see, you know, it's got lots of features in here, some of which were important for the benchmark, some of which weren't, but it's basically designed as a toolkit, a kind of generalized, I need to make something fast, or I want to write something in a specific style. And it makes a certain style of programming much, much easier. And it starts with an abstract buffer definition. Sorry for changing tax on you, but I didn't want to call it array. And the reason is that array is such an overloaded term, and vector is an overloaded term, and list is an overloaded term, and all these other things. Buffer is also an overloaded term, but in general, a buffer is a group of things. And this is my analogy to an array, but in any case, it's countable. So it's the first rule, is countable, and it's random access. So I know exactly how long it is, and it doesn't cost me any more to get to byte 1 million as it does to get me to byte 1. All of them cost about the same time, and it better be close to constant. The other thing arrays have is they have a type. So I can say that this is an unsigned byte array. This is a signed character array, or there's various object types that we would put in arrays. And the beauty of this abstract buffer definition, what I hope to convince you of, it, for one thing, it unifies JVM and native heap programming. So it's funny, I don't know where this came from, but somewhere along the line, somebody decided when they were writing Java that heap-based memory was a Java array and off-heap memory was a native array. That's a bad way to put it. Fundamentally, they're both heap memory. If your program runs out of heap, it doesn't matter if it's a Java array or whatever. So C# has a better nomenclature around this. It's called managed versus unmanaged, but I just call it JVM versus native heap. A JVM heap is a Java array. It's something that'll be garbage collected. A native heap buffer is a native array. It's something that you will have to man the resources on somehow, one way or another. In any case, this buffer definition allows you to create purely abstract buffers. Interestingly enough, if you wanted to create an abstract list in Java, you'd have to write 20 methods, maybe 15. You should only have to write two. I need a count, and I need to resolve an index to a value. There's only two methods to a buffer. Potentially, optionally, it has a data type. But if it doesn't have a data type, then it's type object. And I think addressing that allows me kind of to really quickly create new buffers in different situations, and you'll see where that kind of comes into play. Given our abstract buffer definition, it's really easy for us to write a derived buffer that takes some extra data and computes any given answer upon access to that index. And so this is a way that we can create lazy non-caching arithmetic and buffer manipulations. So like transducers, I went lazy and non-caching because anything else in this domain especially is not going to work. And this is actually one of the interesting areas where I think the JVM has a true advantage. And it's subtle here because in my example below, the combined variable adds the left-hand side to the right-hand side at equivalent indexes. And it creates a new object that you can index into, and you can index into it with a typed operation of get long. But that typed operation is a virtual function call. NumPy, any C++ library I've ever seen, they will almost never accept, well, they'll never accept a virtual function call per element access. On the JVM, we have really fast virtual function calls. So this is one area where I can create an abstract buffer design, and I can create this lazy non-caching arithmetic or kind of composition abstraction. And because we're on the JVM, it works pretty well. For instance, I do not believe you could have a virtual function call for every index in JavaScript and have that perform well. On top of this, that library, dtype next, contains a concept called vectorized dispatch, which simply means that scalars are broadcast to the type that the operation will return. So if I have an operation of two variables and both of them are scalars, it's going to return a scalar. If one's a sequence, I use a list in my example here, it's going to return a list. And if both of them are readers, which is something countable, something that derives from java.util. I think it's called random access, which persistent vectors do, or an array, or a native buffer, then it's going to return another countable reader that will realize its result lazily. The cost of that is that my operations that use this vectorized dispatching system, and by the way, this vectorized dispatch will probably only get more expensive over time because I'll probably want to add in data type specific dispatching, because when you deal with complex numbers, the definition of plus and times are different. But the dispatch cost is high, so you can't do in my functional namespace, there's a plus operator. You can't do reduce plus in that namespace and have it perform well. Your plus has to be outside, because that plus, every time it's called, is going to try to dispatch on the arguments and figure out a really fast way to get the job done. The whole system is designed for buffers that are sizable. If you have small, tiny little buffers, this won't work. But when you have buffers of a million things, taking time and deciding how you want to dispatch each one of your operations on those larger buffers is worth it. It makes a big difference. So this is where having countable buffers is really important. I can do operations in index space, which pretty much doesn't exist anywhere in Clojure. I have a set of operations that are analogies to a lot of Clojure core functions. And instead of returning the data passed in, rearranged somehow, they return indexes. So, and they're often not lazy. Whereas in Clojure, plus is a non-lazy operation. And this sublanguage filters a non-lazy operation. And that's so I can parallelize it. So you can see here, there's a set of things and they basically match Clojure core things. They start with arg. And the reason they start with arg is because arg sort, arg min, and arg max have historical precedence. And once I get, the last thing that's probably important, or another thing that's probably important, is once I get an array of indexes, it's really easy for me to curate a derived buffer that's just indexed via that array of indexes. That's actually really key for that example that you saw. That ability. And this allows me to do things like filter on one column and then broadcast and then use those indexes to create a set of derived columns. So I can run through a small subset of my data, but I can kind of broadcast what the results of that across many more columns of the data. This is something you commonly do in APL. You commonly do it in NumPy. And it's something that I think you need a countable random access object to make work well. So here we have, we're going to sum just a few doubles. I have an array of a million doubles. A million in my world isn't that much. And a million doubles takes about 8 megs if it's in a double array. And it takes 28 megs if it's in a persistent vector or an object array. So boxing those doubles makes them 4 times larger. Just right there, you've increased the size of your data set 4 times. And doubles are, boxing an integer is worse than boxing a double, because integers are smaller, but the object size of an integer is about the same size as the object size of a double. And I really quick here show an example of using Clojure.core reducers fold, which is a parallelized fold. And I'm showing two things here. Interestingly enough, fold doesn't parallelize on arrays, and not primitive arrays, it doesn't. And it only parallelizes if you have a persistent vector. And I also want to show how fold plus has numerical errors, is less numerically stable than a specific summation. So the sum that I used in my library uses what's called, I think, Kahan's compensation algorithm. That's not the fastest one. It's one that absolutely does work. And instead of having, who knows, 53 bits of accuracy or whatever a double has, I end up having double that or roughly double that. So I have 100 bits of accuracy. I mean, you could always just make some of the exponents larger and my library would also generate the incorrect result, but just fold plus can generate the result when one of your numbers is 10 to the 16th larger, or your summation number, your summation value is 10 to the 16th larger than the elements that are coming in. I don't think many of you would ever hit this, hence reduce plus is totally reasonable for almost all your code, but you do hit it when somebody's passing in a sequence of data sets and they want to know the mean on a particular value. And that sequence of data sets could potentially hold millions or billions of values. So this is an example where I can get both really good performance and I can get more correctness, which is a double win that we really like to see. And here's another aspect that is crucial to a lot of code, is that I've taken the time to make sure that copying is an extremely optimized pathway. So if you copy an array to an array, it uses array copy, assuming they have the same primitive type. And if you copy an array to a native buffer or a native buffer to a native buffer, then it's going to use copy memory, which is kind of a mem copy, probably just pipes down to mem copy under the covers. Regardless, it's really fast. So making a vector is copying that double array. Cloning is creating a new double array and copying the data into it. On the other side, I show using a native buffer. And I also show kind of how easy it is to create a native buffer with the library if you want to work with native data types and you need to pass that data to a C-based system. And so I actually, earlier in the slides, I talked about how I support zero copy to NumPy, to OpenCV, to Arrow. But if you have a really fast copy operation, zero copy isn't so important because if you're going to switch languages in the first place, you're probably not doing a big O of N operation. You're probably going to do an operation that's significantly more complex, but it does help because I can copy my, I can do all my work in Java and then copy to a NumPy buffer and then work in NumPy for a while. And, you know, SciPy, for instance, we were kind of talking about that earlier in the call. SciPy has quite a lot in it that is really interesting and it's very well written. There've been complaints about the performance of SciPy, but SciPy is very correct, which I think is really important at first. So we talked about having a countable thing and working in index space. So once we agree that we're going to work in index space, then there's a new primitive for parallelizing in that index space. And this is a very simple primitive. And it basically splits num iters evenly over a number of cores, calls index map function once on each core, and then ends up with a list of results per core and calls reduce function on those results. I think that's a very, very simple way to look at it, but the structure of that map reduce has a lot of really good aspects. And those aspects are not easy to replicate in generic code. So assuming you're dealing with a double array, this indexed map reduce is going to split up the indexes evenly, and each core gets a contiguous group of indexes. And what that does is it means each core is accessing memory in order, and it's accessing memory that is only particular to it. And in the example I show here, it's summing into a stack-based variable. So getting the data out of the double array, it's going to go in order, and it's going to it's giving the hardware a lot of good information to predict the next value you're going to get. And it's giving the compiler a lot of good information. There's nothing hidden. It can see that sum is a double variable. It can see that sum is being reduced over in a tight loop. The compiler can see everything you're doing, ideally giving Hotspot the best chance to vectorize everything we're doing without doing any additional work. And then at the end, we're going to take the results of the partial sums and do a final reduction on them. So like in R-fold, your reducer isn't really given a chance to put anything on the stack before the actual iteration starts. You can't give people that chance if you're going to work in value space. The only time you can give people a chance to set up stack space is if you work in iterator space or in index space. There's an analogous map reduce kind of operation for splitterators, which are kind of sloppy done. If you have a sequence and all you can say is, hey, could you split yourself about in half? That's about what a splitterator is. But in any case, this is a different parallelization primitive than I think many of you use or have seen before. It's more verbose in this formulation because I wanted to show what was going on, but it has analogies to CUDA and OpenCL. So if you're going to write a CUDA kernel or an OpenCL kernel, then your actual kernel code looks a little bit like this. You don't get the reduction step. And instead of start IDX and group len, you get the three-dimensional thread group block thread address of your function in your parallelization geometry. But it's a very similar concept where your thread kind of gets a chance to set up whatever state it wants and then iterate over the data as it goes. So that was the low level set of operations that I think are necessary to know to understand how that benchmark was so quick and understand what the next level is. We have an abstract buffer definition. Oftentimes we work in index space, and we have a fast parallelization primitive that has a reduction step at the end of it. I guess there's more to it. Our buffers are data type specific. So there's a double buffer or there's an int32 buffer. We don't work in object space often. We try to avoid it. I think boxing is not very expensive on average, but when you chain together many, many operations and each operation is boxing, and then you try to parallelize the result, you end up with performance that's much worse than what people would get in Java or Scala trying to do the same thing, because they would have kind of type diarrhea, but their type diarrhea would explicitly tell you exactly what's going on. So there would be no boxing. Please don't write that in a Twitter post. So here we're going to work up. Now that we have the ability to deal with a buffer efficiently and without a whole lot of code, we're going to work up to dealing with a column, and specifically a map of name to columns. And the difference between a column and a buffer is a column is the combination of a buffer and a bitmap that tells you the missing set. There's a lot of times in data processing when you will definitely have partial data, and all of you deal with this, and you all deal with it totally transparently because you use map and filter over a sequence of records or a sequence of maps. And that sequence of maps allows you to handle sparsity really well. Records allow you to handle sparsity less well. And for my use case in the dataset library, the sparsity has to be handled with a bitmap in a lot of cases. Because if I have an int32 array, I can't just say one value is not there. I don't want to use a sentinel all the time. Especially with bytes, I don't want to lose a byte to a sentinel. So I have bitmaps to tell me where the missing values are. The dataset library is very, very, very capable of goes from SQL, CSV, TSV. I mean, you see the soup of things going on. Arrow gives you some interesting capabilities. Fundamentally, a dataset is a table, an SQL table. We'll talk about that in a minute. And it has an analogous set of primitives to what you saw in ArgOps, plus a couple more. Another key aspect of it is it's designed from the ground up to be very memory efficient. So one big piece of efficiency is all strings are put into a per column string table. So if you read a big CSV and it doesn't detect that some of the columns are numeric, then it will use a string table for the ones that aren't. Most of the time, this saves you a whole lot of memory. And in the worst case where it saves you none, it slows down your parsing, but it actually doesn't cost that much more. Interestingly enough, if I have a million, let's say UUIDs that I've converted to strings, and I just have them all in RAM, versus if I put them all in a hash table, the hash table is only like 20 or 30% bigger than the RAM was in the first place. So in per column string tables allow me to, on average, save quite a lot of RAM, and sometimes they perform a little worse. Likewise, when you deal with dates, local dates and instances, java.time.localdate and java.time.instant, I convert those to numbers under the covers. So if you load up a normal CSV with a normal time, you know, date in it, those are generally not, don't have time zones on them. The CSV itself is part of a time zone, but like the data in it is not. And so those will come out as a local date. And I store local dates in 32-bit epoch days. And that's quite a large size reduction over an object of a local date. So little tricks here and there allow me to both reduce the size of the data set and allow me to perform quite a few operations more efficiently. Subtracting two integers is a lot faster than saying temporal minus one local date to another. And the result's going to be the same if we agree that there's local dates and epoch days are isometric. So another aspect of data sets that I think I don't have an example of, but is key to understand is once you have a data set, let's say you've loaded a CSV and you have a million entries in it, you can ask it for a MapSeq reader, which is an indexed reader where dereferencing an index returns you a map. So you can convert between a data set, you can create a sequence of maps into a data set, and it will load them all and compress all that down and have a nice efficient in-memory representation of your data. And you can also go back to a sequence of maps really easily so that you don't have to change like your whole processing paradigm. And those maps that it returns you are flyweight maps. So they all share a kind of a schema and they lazily read from the columns upon read. So you're only gonna pay for the data that you actually read. So one option is to have a lot of data and save it into some sequence of arrow files and load all of those arrow files via memory map. And you can load, for instance, way more data than you have local RAM for using memory map this way. And then you can convert them to a sequence of maps and kind of use that as a random access, large scale random access data set. And it will, you have my word, it will work and it will be pretty efficient. And the goal of all of this is twofold. We want to make, number one, we want to make big data more explorable. So using the dataset library allows you to work with data that is probably an order of magnitude larger than what you're able to work with in the REPL now. And you have a big CSV, so some of you are going to say, well, I could load the CSV lazily, and that's true. And then when you want to ask the next question, what happens? You got the mean of column A, but what if you want to know column C and D grouped by column E? Are you going to iterate through your CSV again? And the answer is yes, you will, over and over and over again until you actually get the answers you need out of the data. The dataset library, and this is true of pandas and data.table, they're designed to make these sort of exploratory iterative cycles very, very, very quick. And that allows you to extend your REPL session to larger amounts of data than you're probably used to. You can load a surprising amount of data. You can get answers instantly, especially if they're lazy, but even if they're not, they're pretty quick. And I think it just extends how nice it is to work in a REPL to a whole new paradigm, because Clojure's REPL is the best out of anybody's by far. And with dataset, you get an equivalent to pandas where you kind of have an in-memory database. So you don't have to use Postgres when you have a large data set. You can use the data set library. So what is a data set? It's basically an SQL table or a CSV file. And I've kind of explained some of this before. This is just some examples of me taking various types of data and changing them in to a data set. And it's showing you kind of what the data set thought of the data. So when you work with data sets, a lot of times it will scan your data to know what data type it should be representing your data in, and it'll find missing values and all this kind of stuff for you. And so, you know, reading a CSV means you just load the CSV and all your data comes out in typed fields and the missing values are found. And a lot of things that you guys are doing, maybe you're doing, a lot of people writing Clojure are doing kind of by hand, like, oh, how do I parse local data out of the string and all this stuff. I've kind of taken all that information and put it in the data set, as well as made file formats like Parquet, which are more common than you might think, very accessible without having to install a Hadoop cluster. So given a data set, which, as I said, stores the data pretty efficiently, we have a lot of operations, and these were designed to map to Clojure core operations. So doing data set processing only uses a single arrow. It's always thread first, but it uses a lot of the same concepts that you're used to. And it can use a lot more. I mean, a lot. The difference is that there's a level of optimization that you can access if you want to, that you can't access doing map, seek, or transducer-based operations. Like group by is parallelized. I'll show examples of this. Group by is parallelized, sort is parallelized. You can still use assertion disoc. Not sure how you guys shorten that in various countries, but you can use some Clojure core functions. Map, the operation Clojure map is replaced with column map, and that's because it takes a, you know, sequence of columns and produces, it takes a data set and you specify a bunch of information and produces a new data set. I've joins, so there's some of your bigger data set operations. You can join two data sets together. The result is virtualized. So you can have two small tables, and a join can be, you know, a join can be much larger than the two tables summed in terms of their size. But because I work in index space, all it is a bunch of series of select statements, essentially, on the two data sets to create the new data set. And then, I talked about this. We have a reader. We can create a sequence of maps from the data set. So it's really easy to go from sequence of maps to a data set, do some data set processing, go back to a sequence of maps. Nobody knows the better. And I talked about the bottom of the slide as well. With Arrow, we can memory map data sets far larger than what is possible. The RAM limits your machine. Some of you that matters a lot to, and some of you have access to machines in the cloud where that's just never going to be the issue. So this is the primitive that you saw earlier in the benchmark code, group by column ag. And what it does is it goes through one column, creates a hash map, and each bucket of that hash map holds a reducer in it. It doesn't hold a new data set. And the map, potentially I should go back and show you guys the code again, but the map of reducers, that's the second argument to group by column, or third argument to group by column ag. Each one of those produces a reducer, and I reduce it all in line, in parallel, per value that you're getting out. And the design of this function is one reason why the benchmark was fast. The other reason why the benchmark was fast, honestly, is because Java has an amazing implementation of a concurrent hash map. I can't say much about that. It's really fast. And I mean really fast for a C library. It's really fast for a Rust library. It's really fast for any library when it's used in a system of heavy concurrency. It has lossless updates to buckets if you use their compute if present and compute if absent functions. And that right there, if you were gonna yourself try to write a lossless hash map that allowed you to update a bucket in place. That's really non-trivial, and not every language has that. You don't find that in all languages, and Java's implementation of that is really good. So that's something we should consider, is maybe understanding the tools of the JVM that we're not familiar with that are themselves really, really, really good. And I assure you, java.useful.concurrent.concurrent-hashmap is a very, very, very good tool. So that was a lot of the benchmark. Another interesting part of that benchmark was the count unique. Count unique is really hard, especially if you don't have values that fit in 32-bit spaces. This is why we have an algorithm called hyperloglog. But if you happen to have dates, so they fit in 32 bits, or product type, or whatever, there's lots of values that are like, there's less than 4 billion of them, then we can use a bitmap to use your count unique. And the bitmap will often outperform just everything else by a lot. One of the things in dtype next is I found, thanks to Tom Poole, I found a really high performance bitmap implementation. And that's one of the things that's just hard linked into dtype next, is a high performance bitmap implementation. And I also want to give a shout out here to Nippy. Nippy for dataset work is actually kind of amazing in that it performs nearly as well as Parquet, and sometimes much, much better. And it's general. So you could have an heterogeneous object graph where some of the leaf nodes are data sets and Nippy the whole thing. This is really useful in machine learning, because you can save some level of your intermediate results or some of your analysis. Your analysis may produce 10 or 12 different data sets, each one exploring some different level of your analysis. And you can literally put them all into a map and save them all with Nippy, and you don't have to do any more work. And that is not easy to do in Parquet. It's not easy to save heterogeneous structures where some of that data is tabular, some of that data is rectangular, and some of the data isn't. And Nippy gives us that capability, and it does it no complaints every time. There is an isomorphism between data sets and sequences of maps. And I think data sets are a specialized implementation of a sequence of maps. And the two rules are your maps share most of the keys and sparsity is relatively rare. For most of the time, if you have a million of anything, probably these two rules hold. Sometimes they won't, probably they hold. So I show here a few performance differences. If you want to have, you know, I have a million maps of three keys. So these are probably going to be array maps. So they're more efficient than a generalized Clojure persistent map with three keys. And yet a data set is almost 10 times smaller than all these maps in memory. And doing various operations, group by, is much, much faster with the data set, because what I talked about, this group by column is going to do the group by in parallel, and it's going to broadcast the indexes across the rest of the columns. And that is just a very efficient paradigm. And in fact, if you want to make it more efficient, you can just group by, there's another function called group by to index. You can literally just have a map of key to lists of indexes. And that would take significantly less time. It turns out constructing a data set takes, well, not in this case, there's only 20 possible ones, but there's times when that's a good tool to have in your back pocket. So I show just a straight group by call on the left. On the right, I show a short little processing thing. This is the type of code I think anybody in Clojure has written a million times. And it's just something the data set library is really well designed for. So the filter is, you filter by a column, passing in a custom Clojure function to do the filtering. And then everything else, you're just using the math subsystem of the data type library to perform. And, you know, it performs a bit better. And I can tell you that as your data gets wider, as data ends up having 20 columns or 30 columns or a couple thousand columns as opposed to three, the data set moves further and further away from core Clojure performance. As well as it gives you the ability to fairly easily drop into NumPy or drop into pandas or drop into lots of different things to switch the mode of where you're working due to data types underlying C infrastructure. So the hardware, this is something we can't ever get away from. Coming from NVIDIA and programming C++, you know, I never ever stop thinking about the hardware that I'm running on. It's just something that never leaves my mind. I cannot program a computer without thinking about what the hardware is doing. And sometimes that's not good, but a lot of times, especially when you write a, when I write a high performance data processing system, that is good. And my point here is that the commonality between a GPU and a CPU is that if you want to access memory in a predictable fashion, and you want to do the kind of a few hyper-optimized algorithms and kind of wire them together in various different ways. Another interesting aspect is that recomputing partial results is often faster than accessing a cached version. And that's certainly true when, you know, the results are simple and there's a whole lot of data, and potentially having a partial result in memory means you blow out your memory budget. But it's true for a lot of situations. A long time ago at NVIDIA, we saw the chief scientist of NVIDIA at the time, his name was Bill Daly. He had a talk called From Cell Phones to Supercomputers. And what NVIDIA was really interested in at the time, and the interesting thing about cell phones and supercomputers, the one commonality between them is that they're both power limited environments. We can't scale supercomputers by factors of two easily anymore, because supercomputers are taking gigawatts to run, or at least megawatts to run. So our ability to process more information comes down to understanding where that power is being used. And in, of course, at NVIDIA, your job is to know, like, you can't just wave your hand and say somebody will make it faster. Your job is to make it faster. So, you know, Bill looked at that in depth, and what he found was moving data around the GPU costs a lot. The actual FPU and ALU, the components on a CPU that do the thing, that add a two results together, whether it's integer arithmetic, integer floating point arithmetic, those don't take very much power at all. But grabbing the data, especially from main memory, but even from caches, grabbing the data oftentimes is a lot. So what that means is you want to get some portion of your result local, especially as you move from like 8 cores to 72 cores to on a GPU, you really should be thinking about hundreds of thousands of cores. It doesn't have 100,000 cores, but it has 100,000 hardware threads that are always running and can't be stopped. So you got to kind of think of your problem in the space of hundreds of thousands of cores. You want to get your some portion of your data local, and then it's relatively cheap to recompute partial results as long as your overall data set stays local. So that's an interesting rule there. And because we're on the JVM, we're worried about hotspot, or some of us are, and hotspot is kind of a moving target. I think when I started in 2015, hotspot really had very limited ability to vectorize operations. I feel like hotspot is much better at vectorizing now. Maybe that'll be another talk, because I've kind of played around with how good it is. But regardless, if you want to win a benchmark on the JVM, then you definitely have to program to hotspot. And that's an interesting programmatic target that I think is not really that well explored. And yes, there's a million articles on it, but first principles, hotspot, what will it vectorize? What will it won't? What will it not vectorize? That kind of thing. When does hotspot insert potentially memory barriers or some sort of concurrency primitive or whatever? Understanding all these sorts of things is I think harder than it should be. I really wish there was a standard compilation target and hotspot had standard optimizations it would do. So if you made your code look like this, then Hotspot was guaranteed to produce a result like that. And if it didn't, it was a bug. But that's not yet where it is. On the other hand, we have JEP338. And for those of you who don't know, JEP338 is SYND instructions. So instead of working with one double, I'm working with four doubles at a time. And it's similar to all the other SYND, AVX512, or all the other SYND libraries. It's a subset of them. It transfers to Neon. But JEP338 changes this, because now, in some ways, we do have guarantees. Like if I give Hotspot a bunch of these vectorized instructions and it doesn't vectorize them, then there's a bug. So moving beyond Hotspot, I want to talk about how we structure our programs. This is, I think, one of the interesting fallouts of using the dataset library, is that we end up restructuring our data from rows to columns. And I show like an example here. An efficient map operation is an adduction of map, and then an efficient dataset operation. And you know, as I said, my plus operator gets to see the full definition of A and B. And the full definition is it's a column of A and a column of B. Does A and B have any missing? Are A and B both backed by Java primitive arrays? Are they potentially backed by native memory? All these sorts of things could be reasons that I structure that plus operator differently under the covers. Clojure's plus operator inside the loop of map can't do that much work. And it does an amazing job for the work that it does do, but it can't possibly. We got to move some of these operations out of the loops. So this adduction, if you have a million maps, whether you do it lazily or not, has to produce well more than a million, probably 5 million intermediate values. So it's going to box the result of A and B. It's going to add a new, you know, bucket to the hash table. It's going to do that for every single entry it gets. When we flip the problem, and that's a row major definition, and that's how row major programming works. You're in the loop. When we flip the definition to column major programming, then the data set, yes, it produces one new hash table bucket, which is where C goes, and it produces one new garbage collected thing, which may be a virtualized or concrete double array, double buffer. But regardless, we're talking about a constant number of things that it produces. So I have a data set of a million objects, and regardless of what you do, you know, I'm producing a constant number amount of garbage on each one. This is ideal for garbage limited environments, is what I'm going to say. So if it wasn't for this truth of this fact, pandas on Python could not work. Because Python's GC is so much weaker than the JVMs. And it's also why using the dataset library, tech.ml dataset on Graal Native is so interesting. Because Graal Native, unless you want to pay for the corporate license, which none of us are going to do ever, Graal Native has a really weak garbage collector. So you actually, my experiments have said that Graal Native in dense numeric code is about half as fast as the JVM. However, when you start pinning its garbage collector, it's much, much slower. It's got the old school serial garbage mark and sweep garbage collector. Sorry about that. And so using dataset type programming, using working in columns and that kind of thing on GraalVM makes a ton of sense. It means you can get a Graal native program that can process a whole lot of data, starts up instantly, and doesn't spend a lot of time collecting garbage. So here's the definition of group by. One interesting aspect, you know, group by on the left-hand side has to go through the entire data set at some level. You know, it's going to go through every map. And the data set definition of group by, as I said earlier, isn't going to go through every column value. It's going to go through one column, exactly one column, and it's going to produce a bunch of indexes, a map of keyed index, and it's going to do a select operation on every other column. And that's just a different design of how group by could work. And it's also parallelized, which makes a big difference as your data set grows. So let's pick on Spark. Why not? Spark, at its heart, is a row major data processing system. It's funny that they have a column major stores for Spark, and it's irrelevant because the Spark processing model is in row major. So if you write a custom thing of Spark, then you're processing your data record by record. And in Spark's definition, that is defined to be row major. Your records have to serialize one by one. And so Spark can't possibly take advantage of arrow in a meaningful way. It kind of can. Yeah, you can create an arrow file from Spark, but you can't write Spark processing that takes advantage of column major data sets. And I think that's a major design flaw in Spark. Stepping up from picking on Spark specifically, if we look at what happens in Scala or Java code, we get this explosion of intermediate types as each step of your processing pipeline, every time you map, you are creating a new intermediate type. You know, like you're mapping from your basic input records, which are defined by a type, to your basic input records that have a mean on them, which is defined by yet another type. So you end up with your filter. When we would write double arrow, they end up with a type for each one of those lines a lot of times. And I just think that's a side effect of row major thinking and row style processing, is that in order to do row major processing, in order to process record by record efficiently, you have to have types. You really do. This is why we have records, actual records in Clojure. Because as your data set grows, you want to give the compiler information about what you're doing. The other, actually, to step back for a second, speaking of row major, to while we're on the subject, the plus operator on the right-hand side here has a chance to vectorize this operation. So if A and B are stored in contiguous containers and we decide we want plus to not be lazy because for whatever reason it's not lazy, then we can do a vectorized operation of adding A and B and putting the result in C. The row major definition of this problem, you cannot vectorize. It doesn't make sense. You have to have four records at least to vectorize it. And then the records would have to be stored very particular way in memory. And it's just not possible, actually. So when you program in row major, certain problems when programmed in row major form, you lose the last 20 years of CPU research because you can't vectorize the result. You can't use the high-end instructions on those types of operations. At the end of the day, when we're dealing with types, especially when there's a lot of intermediate types, they're just a contrived form of incidental complexity. And I think this is a point that Rich has made. I'll probably get flamed about this at some point, but the truth is, the intermediate types in the middle of your processing chain, you know, they don't exist in the problem space. They don't exist in the space of the computing hardware. Computer hardware really doesn't have types, period. And they definitely don't exist in the space of your client. So there is some form of machined complexity, made up contrived complexity that is there. And I think a lot of it is a side effect of thinking about your problems as records. Here's the advantage of row major form, is that you can think about your problem on the space of individual records, and it still makes sense. Whereas as soon as you're going to think about things in column major form, you really have to batch your data, because a data set with only one row in it, a persistent map is going to perform a lot better than that. But as you move up the scale of data that you're going to process, then having an efficient way to batch things ends up being pretty necessary. You can't reach a decent potential of what your machine's capable of unless you batch. Batching increases, throughput, quote, at the cost of latency, but garbage collectors also cost a lot of latency. So at times you can get an increase in both throughput and in latency when you batch, simply because the machine's doing so much less work. And if you're clever with your batching, of course. So to flip it over, if each row is a data set, now you're back to where using kind of row major thinking makes sense. I'm batching my data into a sequence of data sets, and I'm going to transduce over that sequence of data sets. And that's where lazy non-caching behavior is really what you want, because you risk running the machine out of RAM otherwise. And transducing an operation over a sequence of data sets, I think, is a natural pathway to get a large percentage of the maximum theoretical performance out of the JVM. And I really think that that's an interesting form of research, is how do we unlock more performance out of the JVM, and how do we make it easier? How do we get a tighter alliance between Hotspot and the people writing code, so that we can get more guarantees out of Hotspot and we can make Hotspot's job a little easier? So in any case, using Clojure and transducers and data sets and all the other amazing things that are in Clojure, I think you do have a high performance computing language at your fingertips. Nobody's going to believe you that you have one of those, but the truth is, you have my word, you do. I have a few more slides, but I want to stop here. Thank you very much. Email me, flame me at my email address or on Reddit if you want to. I'm going to stop sharing. This is a picture of my son Aster when he's bouncing around and having a blast. I thought maybe you guys would enjoy that.